Good morning. We stand up together as we sing this morning, Revive Us Again. Hallelujah, thine the glory. Hallelujah, amen. Revive us again.
Opportunity to come and to kneel and to sing and to pray. Father, we come to worship you. Father God, as we worship this morning, through the help us to worship you through the music, through the message, through the readings and through the prayers. Help our hearts and our thoughts to be focused upon you and you alone. Father God, as we worship this morning, Lord, we ask that you might light a spark within every heart. Lord, blow upon the flames with your Holy Spirit, Father. Let us be purified. Let us be made cleansed. Let us be made righteous in your sight. Father God, we ask you to help us to grow in your faith this morning, Father. Lord, help us truly be more like your Son, Jesus Christ. It's in his name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
May be seated. Well, good morning.
Good morning.
I'd like to welcome everyone to First Baptist Church of Flagler Beach. I am so glad that we're all worshiping together this morning. And I'm also so glad I see some faces I haven't seen before. That's always a wonderful thing. If this is your first time worshiping with us this morning, we have a visitor's pack, and if you're out in front of you, there's some information in there about the different ministries of our church. We encourage you to take one as our gift to you. If at all possible, we would ask that you fill out a visitor's card and leave in the offering plate as it comes by. A few brief announcements. Number one, we are needing nursery volunteers. We have had to make some changes to the church ministries. We have moved away from a paid nursery worker, but that means we need volunteers. Doesn't require any special training. It does require a background. And so if you're interested in talking about this, see me after the worship service or call the church office or contact Desiree Munt. We can put you in touch with her. But at any rate, we just need some volunteers, some people who love working with the little ones. Also, it is that time of the year. The Super Bowl will be here before you know it. And that's why we are having Super Bowl Sunday, where we are collecting cans of soup to go in our food ministry. If you've ever worked the food pantry, you know how it goes. People come in, people come out, food comes in, food goes out. And so we are in constant need there. Let me encourage everyone to make that a matter of prayer. Also on our calendars, March the 20th and 21st, we have a rummage sale coming up. If you're looking to clean out a closet, clean out a garage, clean out an attic or a storage shelter, this is the time to do it. I have two requests. Number one, start collecting your goods. Number two, don't bring them yet. We don't have a place to store them, not yet. And so that's going to March the 20th and 21st. As we have more information about collection dates, we will certainly be passing that along to you. Also, the men's and the women's ministries, they both have different Bible studies coming up. Women are meeting on Mondays at 10 o'clock. Men are meeting on Mondays or Thursday nights. You have your choice. Any questions about that, please see Ed or Debbie Gilkey. Also, the women's ministry has got their tea coming up this Saturday. They need a head count. There is a sign-up sheet on Mary's table out in the foyer. Also, as announced this past week, mark your calendars. March the 29th through the April the 1st, we'll be having revival services here. They'll begin Sunday morning. It'll go Sunday night, Monday night, Tuesday night, and Wednesday night. I encourage everyone to come and be making that a matter of prayer. We almost have everybody lined up, but we've still got a few slots to go. And so we'll be passing out more information about that as it becomes available. Also, I want to make you aware this coming Wednesday night, we are starting a new series. This past fall, we looked at the footsteps of Jesus. This winter, we'll be looking at the footsteps of Paul. We're looking at the Damascus Road experience and everything that God did with him. And so let me encourage everyone to come out. Wednesday nights, we have activities for youth, children, and adults. And so, Barry, that's all the announcements I've got, but let's worship.
Worship His Majesty, unto Jesus, the all glory. morning.
I'm going to talk to you this morning about some of our missionaries who are in London. When I think of London, of course, we think of the Queen and all the majestic things that go on in England. As we pray for our missionaries today, Alex and Jess Garcia, let's think about them. You probably think that maybe London is a Christian city because it has some historic church buildings and the like. I'm sorry to say that's wrong. It's a city of more than 8 million people, most of whom have no relationship with Christ. If you think New York City is big, I guess London is probably 3 or 4 times as big. It's also a very challenging city because people from around the world now live in London, and they speak more than 300 languages. Are many missionaries needed in London? Yes, of course they are. If you were a missionary in London, think about it for a minute. Would you want other churches from around the world to be praying for you? Of course you would. And that's why today we're going to pray for two of these special missionaries, Alex and Jess Garcia, who serve in London. We already support them financially through 10% of our tithes and offerings. Every month when we give, or every week, 10% of our offering goes to the missionaries that we support through the co-op program. Amen. London is very big, but they are helping plant new churches around the city. Every week, people are saved and they ask for baptism. And if one person is baptized, that often inspires others to be baptized, the same as it is here. Let's pray now for Alex and Jeff and ask God to give them powerful visions in that city. Father, we just come to you this morning and ask that you lay your hand on Alex and Jeff Garcia. Give them some special thoughts this morning and let them know that there are people around the world praying for them, and that we know that what they're doing is hard in many cases, and we just ask you to give them the wisdom and the guidance and the strength, Lord, to continue on the work there. Right now in our church, Lord, we ask that you bless our offering that we're about to receive, and that you'll let your people know that we appreciate their generosity, because we have many needs in our own town. And we do help people through benevolence, and have very many needs right here in our own town. And we appreciate the offering we're about to receive. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen. Amen.
Chapter 4, 20 through 24.
But you did not learn Christ in this way, if indeed you have heard and been taught him, just as truth is in Jesus, that in reference to your former manner of life, you lay aside the old self, which is being corrupted in accordance with the lust of deceit, and that you may be renewed in the spirit of your mind and put on the new self, which is in the likeness of God, being created in righteousness and holiness of the truth. Christian walk is just that. It is a journey. You start at one place and you go to another. We are called to do more than just simply talk about being Christians. We are called to be new. We are called to be different. We are called to be changed.
Amen.
Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Most gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, this morning we offer all the praise to you that we can give, Father. We praise you from our voices. We praise you from our hearts, Father. We praise you with all the strength that we have, Father. We praise you because you are our God and we are your people, Father. You created each and every one of us, Father. You gave us life. Father, you have given us so many blessings day in and day out, we cannot even begin to count them. Father, you gave us your Son. Father, you gave us your Son because, Father, even though you have given us so many different blessings, Father, we have still chosen to sin, still chosen to do things that are wrong. And so, Father, we come and acknowledge this before you this day, Father, and ask for your forgiveness. Father God, we thank you for sending your Son into the world, Father, to live, to die, to rise on the third day, Father. Lord, we thank you for this gift of forgiveness and redemption that is freely available. Father God, we thank you for your Holy Spirit that gives comfort and counsel, your Holy Word which gives guidance and instruction. Father God, we thank you for the privilege of living in a nation such as this, where we are free to worship you openly and freely. Father, we pray for all of our elected officials across this nation, Father, here in Flagler Beach and Flagler County. Father, we pray for the state government in Tallahassee. Father, we pray for Washington, D.C., for the Supreme Court, for Congress, for our President, Donald Trump. Lord, we ask for wisdom and guidance in all that they do. Father God, as we continue to worship you this hour, Lord, we ask that you might light a flame within every heart. Father, we ask that you might reawaken us all to your Spirit. Lord, help us to be reawakened and reminded of your daily presence in our lives. Lord, help us to always look to you, Father. Lord, help us to continue to grow. Help us to become more like your Son, Jesus Christ. Father God, it's in his name we pray. Amen. At this time, I'd like to invite all the children, third grade and under, to be dismissed for Children's Church.
So one of the ways that we worship the Lord is we know it's through music and singing. And so we're going to be, you're going to be hearing from me, and you'll be hearing from choir members who will be coming to you personally one-on-one and asking you to come and be part of our choir, maybe to sing with our Easter music especially, or just all the time. Because we have a lot of people up here, but we have chairs, empty chairs, and we have more chairs in here than we can put out. So we want everyone to have that opportunity to make a joyful noise and or to use the talent of music that the Lord has given you to come and sing with us. So if someone comes to you, you remember I sent them. So I'm the messenger. So you come to me. But we really are encouraging you to come and sing, and you be prayerful about that, because they do a great job, but they're always open to having others come and join us. We are not a closed group. Listen as we sing a song that you can almost sing with us. Glory to his name.
Down with the cross where my Savior died. Down with the cleansing.
You see that phrase advertised on television, new and improved, and a lot of times, you know, it is something new and it is improved. They figure out a better way to make a certain type of pasta, maybe, or a certain vehicle, or new kind of computer, or something like that, and it's always exciting to see the things that are coming out. But once upon a time, there was a new and improved that wasn't really, well, it was new, but I don't know that it was improved. How many of you remember the whole story about the new Coke way back about 30 years ago? Y'all remember that mess? Yeah, for those of you that are too young to remember that, Coca-Cola is one of the software giants of the industry. And their flagship product, Coca-Cola, the sales had been dropping. So they said, oh, we've got to do something different. So they changed the formula to this thing. They announced, hey, we've got ourselves a new Coke. And sales tanked. Everyone says, you've got to be kidding me. So they came out and they said, okay, we're going to bring back the old Coca-Cola and we're going to rename it Coke Classic. And they said it'll be the exact same, except it really wasn't. Did y'all notice that? That after they came out with Coke Classic, it still wasn't quite the same as the original Coke. They said, well, all we did was change the sweetener. Well, yeah, that'll do that. And so after it was all over with, my wife and I visited the Coke Museum in Atlanta, and they talked about that. And the guy who was telling the story said, after it's all over with, so many people accused the Coca-Cola Corporation of making one big PR stunt out of the whole thing. They said, you guys planned this thing from the very beginning. And he said, Coke's response was, we're not that smart and we're not that dumb. And so
But it's just one of those things that just kind of worked out like that. But how many times do we talk about something being new? And it is definitely new, but is it improved? You know, when Christ comes into our hearts, He makes us a new person, a new man, a new woman. But here's the thing. We're not just supposed to be new. We're supposed to be improved.
Amen.
We're not supposed to be like we were before. I'm reminded, and some of y'all heard me tell the story about one time, those who know me at all know that I'm a University of Georgia football fan. And I got in a discussion one time years ago with another guy who was also a Georgia fan, and he commented about how he hated Georgia Tech. And I said, well, I don't hate Georgia Tech. I might look down my nose at him just a little bit, but I don't hate Georgia Tech. He says, now, if you're a real Georgia fan, you got to hate Georgia Tech. I said, a real Christian doesn't hate anybody. He said, no, when you become a Christian, it doesn't change your personality. I said, it better. I mean, what's the point if it doesn't? We are supposed to be new and improved. I want to look at a passage of Scripture that is, if you're a new Christian, or if you're maybe stuck in a rut and you're not growing like you should, or maybe you need a refresher course on what it means to live as a Christian, it's a good one to look at, it's a good one to study. Open up your Bibles, if you could please, to Colossians chapter 3. Colossians chapter 3, beginning in verse 1. And we're going to go through 14. Colossians chapter 3, beginning in verse 1. If then you have been raised up with Christ, keep seeking the things above, where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. Set your mind on the things above, not on the things that are on earth. For you have died, and your life is hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is our life, is revealed, then you also will be revealed with Him in glory. Therefore, consider the members of your earthly body as dead to immorality, impurity, passion, evil desire, and greed, which amounts to idolatry. For it is on account of these things that the wrath of God will come, and in them you also once walked when you were living in them. But now you also put them all aside: anger, wrath, malice, slander, and abuse of speech from your mouth. Do not lie to one another, since you have laid aside the old self with its evil practices, and have put on the new self, which is being renewed to a true knowledge according to the image of the one who created him, a renewal in which there is no distinction between Greek and Jew, circumcised and uncircumcised, barbarian, Scythian, slave and freeman, but Christ is all and in all. And so those who have been chosen of God, holy and beloved, put on a heart of compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience, bearing with one another and forgiving each other. Whoever has a complaint against anyone, just as the Lord forgave you, so also should you. And beyond all these things, put on love, which is a perfect bond of unity. Amen and amen. This was a passage of Scripture that when I first became a discipling Christian, and that was when I was about 20 or 21 years old. And I accepted Christ in my life when I was 13, but there were several years where I was, how shall I put this delicately, not living a Christian lifestyle. And we'll just simply leave it at that. Thank you very much. But this passage, when I was in college, I went through a series of discipleship programs, and one of them had us memorize this entire chapter from beginning to end. Not all at once. Each day you would take a verse and you add it to what you memorized the day before. So the first day you just simply memorize verse 1. Number 2, you add verse 2 to that. And so it took you about 4 or 5 weeks to get through the whole chapter. But as I said, this gives you a good how-to on this thing. Do not ask me to repeat this thing from memory today. I cannot do it. But looking at chapter 3, verse 1, he says, if you've been raised... Now, you have to remember who Paul is writing this to. He's writing this not to a bunch of people that go to the temple of Apollo and worship there. He's writing to a church. He's writing to a group of Christians. Now, some of your translations may have, since you have been raised. We would presume that someone that is in a church, that is a member of a church, they have made a profession of faith, they have asked Jesus to come into their life, and that they therefore are saved. But Paul is recognizing there is an uncertainty there. All you know is what you see. Only God knows a person's heart. The first seven verses, he kind of sets the foundation. Set your minds on things above. Don't be worried about things here on the earth. Set your mind on things above. And he said, and consider the members of your earthly body as dead to immorality, impurity, passion, evil desire, greed, which amounts to idolatry. These are some of the more serious sins that you see. Immoral lifestyle, greed, idolatry. Verse 6, he says, for it is on account of these things that the wrath of God will come. And then in verse 7, note that he says, and them you also once walked when you were living in them. So you have here a group of believers that once upon a time, they were living a life of immorality, of greed, of sensuality. But they got saved, and they quit living that way. They had progressed beyond that. Then in verse 8, he begins the word, but. Anytime you see that word, but, in the Bible, that's a change in direction. We're going this way, but now we're going that way. Paul says, you've done fairly well. You've accepted Christ. You've put aside all these different things, but now you also put them all aside. What you have here is a group of people who can say, well, I haven't done the big stuff, at least not since I got saved. I'm not sinning anymore, not like that. I'm not running around on my spouse. I'm not stealing. It's not enough to say, I haven't sinned like that. We need to do more than just simply say, I'm no longer living that kind of a lifestyle. Part of the problem that you seem to have had in Colossae is you seem to have had a group of people that, yes, they accepted Christ. Yes, they put aside the big sin, but they were content. Content to go no further. Okay, I've attained a certain level of holiness. That's good. That's good enough. But here's the thing. Good enough for us is good enough for God. We need to have, number one, a higher standard than that. If we're going to be new and improved, we've got to have a higher standard. Just simply saying, you haven't committed any of the big sins, at least not this week, is not good enough. Long term. Now, if you're a new Christian, that's a whole different story. If you're a new Christian, if you're a baby Christian, you're still cleaning out, trying to clean out the big stuff. Yeah, I totally get that. But if you've been a believer for 5, 10, 15, 20 years, I would hope that stuff is long gone. And I hope you're not satisfied with where you are. I hope you have a higher standard than just simply, well, I haven't done any of the big stuff lately. You know, there was a day when the United States led the world in industrial production. We had factories, especially up in the Northeast and the upper Midwest. They sent their goods out all over the world. We sent cars, we sent TVs and radios and whatnot. And American made, you can find those products everywhere. Products from other countries like Japan were considered to be inferior. But things have changed. I once saw a documentary on the Japanese industrial system about how they came to where they are today. They said it's very simple. We start with a factory that it might put out, say, a quality product 90% of the time. Let's raise it from 90% to 95%. And then once you get to 95%, you raise it from 95% to 97%. And then from 97% to 99%. And you just keep pushing. You keep holding the standard. And over the years, Japanese products in particular have gotten a lot better than they were 50 or 60 years ago. Now, I know there's a lot more going on that as for all the trade stuff going on between one country and another. You know, I could talk all day about that, but I'm not going to. My point is they got better by holding a higher standard. That's true of a business. That's true of a factory. And that's true in here. Amen. We need to be holding a higher standard. It's not enough to say, well, I haven't slapped anybody this week. I'm sure you've run into some people that you felt deserved it, but you got to do better than that. He says in verse 7, you all once walked in them when you were living in them, verse 8, but now you also put them all aside. Anger, wrath, malice, slander. Y'all know what slander is, don't you? It's saying something about somebody that isn't true. A lot of gossip becomes slander, whether we realize it or not. Chew on that for just a few minutes. Abusive speech from your mouth. Now again, remember who Paul is writing this to. He's not writing it to a group of non-believers. He's not writing it to people who worship Zeus. He's writing it to people who claim to worship God, who claim to be Christians, and he's having to tell them to put aside anger and wrath and malice and abusive speech. What all these have in common? All of these begin as internal issues that aren't necessarily widely seen. You know, the immoral lifestyles, that stuff, other people know about it. Other people see it. And anger stays in your heart. And you're the only one that sees that, you and God. Wrath, malice. These are secret sins sometimes. These are sins that are subtle. These are sins that are so easy to hide. But if you look at all of them together, and look at the picture that it paints a picture of someone who, frankly, isn't all that nice. If we're going to be new and improved, we need to have higher standards. We also need to work on our temperaments. We need to have better temperaments. Another way of saying that is we need to be nicer people. If I can put it bluntly, we need to be nicer people. And sometimes Christians are the worst at this. I had a friend of mine, well, an acquaintance is probably the word I should say, that we were living together in New Orleans in the dorm at seminary. Yes, he was a fellow seminary student. And if there's one thing I learned at seminary is that God calls all kinds of people into the ministry. And if you're any of my classmates watching this on Facebook, you know exactly what I'm talking about. We had this one guy that he was a little bit different. He wasn't a bad person necessarily, but none of us, I was warned by the guy that if he wants to take you out to eat somewhere, don't go with him. Because what he would do is, and if you've ever been a server, you know what, you've seen this before, the person where everything has to be just so on their plate. This has to be here, this has to be there. Don't let the food touch. Make sure you fix it like this. Make sure you put it like this. I'm seeing some smiles, I'm seeing some servers in here, I'm guessing that you run into those kind of customers. And then he would try to witness to them after it was all over. Don't do that. Okay, please, I'm begging you, don't do that. If you go out to eat today, be the ideal customer. Be the one they say, I want to be more like that. I want my kids to be like that. We need to have better temperaments than what we've had before. Now, verse 9. Do not lie to one another. Now, hold on just a minute. Are you saying Christians lie to one another? How about this? More often than not, we lie to ourselves. Well, more often lying to each other, we lie to ourselves. He says you've laid aside the old self, you've put on the new, and then there is a renewal there in which there is no distinction between Greek and Jew. Circumcised and uncircumcised, barbarian, Scythian, slave, and freeman. These are the different social groups that you would have in the empire at that time. Slave and free, civilized, uncivilized. He's saying it doesn't matter where you come from. Everybody's had that same renewal. But sometimes we don't want to admit that we're still struggling with this. Given the references here to putting on a new self and being renewed, a picture emerges of people that are not being honest. One criticism that is leveled against the modern church, and I must say it there's more truth to it than we would like to admit, is that sometimes so many of us are fake. And it's not a question of wolves in sheep's clothing. though that does happen from time to time, is that we try to pass ourselves off as being perfect when we're anything but. Case in point, how many of y'all remember the televangelist scandals back in the 80s and 90s? Oh gosh, that was embarrassing. You had Jimmy Baker and his wife Tammy Faye. And to his credit, he has since written a book that says, I was wrong. I have to give credit where it was due. But even he, in his book, tells about how he was living a life full of sin. He'd get there and put on a good show, but then eventually it all came out. Adulterous relationships, misappropriated funds. And Christians have been accused of being fake ever since. My dad, when he was working, he liked to go and get a cup of coffee at a restaurant. You know we got Friends Cafe over here? I think every small town in the South has a restaurant just like that. There was one in my hometown that was very similar to that. And he would go into this restaurant, he would sit down, and he'd have a cup of coffee with his friends. And right in the middle of the Jimmy Baker scandal, one guy was laughing, going, you know, so-and-so, he did watch Jimmy Baker and Tammy Faye. But my guy, the guy that I watch, he'll never get caught up in something like that. His guy was Jimmy Swagger. He got caught, too, in an adulterous relationship. And his elders tried to tell him, you need to step out of the pulpit for a year. We're not going to take your TV program from him. We've got enough stuff on video that we can keep having reruns until you come back. But he refused. Here you have a group of people that were claiming to be messengers of Christ. And all too often we're guilty of the same thing, saying, yeah, we're better than that when we're human. We need to have a higher standard. We need to have a better temperament. Amen. And we need to have increased authenticity. We need to be real. We need to admit that we are still human beings, simply redeemed, simply saved. If there's ever a time when we need more authenticity, I would submit to you that it's today. Then he says in verse 12, as those who have been chosen of God, holy and beloved, put on a heart of compassion. Compassion which leads to kindness, which builds humility, which leads to gentleness and patience, bearing one another, forgiving one another. You see a picture in verse 12, 13, and 14 as how a Christian community should be bound together with love. And look at where it begins. In verse 12, those who have been chosen of God, holy and beloved, put on a heart of compassion. We need to have more compassion. If we would be new and improved, we need to have more compassion. Let me paint another picture for you. It's Friday afternoon. You've gotten off of work. There's a movie coming on that night that you've been looking forward to seeing. You've already got your tickets purchased, so you're ready to go. Uh-oh, where are my car keys? Can't find my car keys. I dig around all over the house. I finally find the car keys right where I left them the last time. I get in the car. I'm running just a few minutes late. So I get out on the road, and I'm headed down towards the movie theater, and it's a two-lane road, double yellow line, so you can't pass. Speed limit is about 35 miles an hour, and you get behind some little old lady going about 25 miles an hour. And you are stuck there. And you're getting more anxious and more anxious and more anxious. And finally, when you get to a place where you can pass, you zoom on by and you give her this nasty look. As you go back. Now she's making you late. You're not going to get to eat all that popcorn before that movie starts. But in that car, there's a little old lady who's coming home from the hospital. Her husband has just passed away. And she's going to an empty house for the first time. And she's crying. She can't keep track of how fast she's going. She doesn't even think about the speed limit. She doesn't think about what her speedometer says. She is just thinking about, what do I do now. And she doesn't even see your dirty look when you blow by her, which is a good thing. You know, when you run up on somebody who's driving slow down the highway, who's struggling to get the change out of her purse at the drugstore, who can't figure out that new and improved card machine at the store, have some compassion. Because you have no idea what their story is. You have no idea what happened to them that morning when they got up. And guess what? You don't need to know what their story is. What you need to know is, Jesus said, love your neighbor. You know, Jesus was brought a woman that they said she has been caught in the act of adultery. Law of Moses says she should be stoned, and that's exactly what the Law of Moses says. What do you say ought to happen? Jesus said, let him who has never sinned cast the first stone. Jesus showed compassion on this woman. It's a new year, 2020. I'm excited about what 2020 is going to bring. I want this to be a new year. I want this to be an improved church, improved people. I want each and every one of us to hold ourselves to a higher standard. I want each and every one of us to work on being a nicer person. As I told someone this past week, being a Christian isn't just about feeling close to God. Even though, don't get me wrong, I hope you do feel close to God. It's also about being a nicer person and a better person and being real and admitting that you struggle with something. And being compassionate when you see someone that's struggling on their own. Because he says, compassion because I'm getting glimpses of bat here. And beyond all these things, put on love, which is the perfect bond of unity.
Amen.
The greatest command Jesus told someone is to love God and to love your neighbor as yourself. And someone said, who's my neighbor? He says, even the Samaritans, even the people you despise, those are your neighbors. Go and love your neighbor. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Most gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, we come before you this morning acknowledging that we want to be new and improved. And Father, you've made us new. Father, we haven't always improved as we should. Father, we just humbly ask your forgiveness this morning, Father. Lord, we ask you might help us to hold ourselves to a higher standard.
Amen.
Lord, help us to continue to work on our temperament, Father. Lord, help us to be nicer people. Father, help us to be genuine and admit that we need you. And Father, help us to be compassionate day in and day out, Father. Lord, help us to love one another. Help us to love our neighbor, whether they are inside this church or outside this church, Father. Help us to love.
Amen.
Father, we love you. We praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to sing a hymn of invitation. This is an invitation. First off, let me introduce you to my best friend. His name is Jesus.
Amen.
It's an invitation from the church. It's an invitation to come to Christ. If you'd like to respond to that invitation, let me encourage you to come forward. Perhaps you feel like that today is the day you would join this fellowship. Let me encourage you to come forward as well. Let's all stand together, please, as we sing, Where He Leads Me.
Where He leads me, I will.
where he's going to take me, son. Take me right to the throne room of God. Please be seated. If you're a visitor, I'm just going to ask you just to bear with us. This will only take just a minute. I need to call us back into conference very quickly. Mike, can I get you to help me out with something? Just pass these out to the church members. Matt, if I can get you to pass these out on this side. If you are not a church member, I need you to decline this. This is just for those that are official church members. And like I said, if you're not, just bear with us. It'll only take just a minute. The budget for 2020 was presented last Sunday. We had the discussion this past Wednesday night. There was discussion about different parts of it. No amendments were offered, and so it is presented. It stands as presented. And so at this time, this is a ballot vote. Just simply check either yes or no, and then we'll have some guys with some offering plates collecting ballots as you go. If you're not a church member, I need to sit this one out if you could, please. If you are a church member, please, but vote only once, okay? Only once. Church members have not gotten a ballot yet. Lee. Is there anybody else who has not gotten a ballot yet? All right. Have you had time to check either yes or no? I'll take the extras. All right. Hearing none. All right. Let's all stand together. Join hands across the aisle, and let's finish with a closing song.